dear students of grade 11 business and accounting studies of St. Peter's College Colombo 4 Nicambo branch. Today we will be starting the first lesson of the accounting section of our syllabus. So that is in chapter 4, and this chapter talks about the financial statements of a business. So to start off the lesson, let me first ask you a question. What is the main objective of a business? As you learned in your business studies and as well as in grade 10, you know the main objective of almost all of the businesses are to earn a profit. So how these businesses know whether they are making profits or losses? So in this particular slide, it says about the objective of the business organizations, and you know there are a lot of stakeholders who are interested in the activities of a business organization, and out of those stakeholders, there are some key stakeholders who are very keen on knowing whether the business performs well or else whether the business is making profits. So therefore, it is very important to know whether the business is making profits or losses. So that is called the financial performance. Whether they are performing well, are they making profits, are they giving a good return to their good return to the owners as well as its investors. So that is called the financial performance. And also it is equally important to know the status of the business. How much is the asset liability position of the business? Whether the assets they are in a business is adequate to pay off the liabilities as well as to give back what is invested by the owners. So that is called the financial position of a business, or else how much is the assets, liabilities and the equity. So that therefore it is called the financial position. Then let's look at what are these financial statements. So you know in accounting there is a process. So we have accounting information, we do process them, and finally there is an outcome of that process. So let's look at what are we doing in this process. So as you learned in grade 10, the business transactions are initially recorded in the prime entry books. So you have learned mainly five prime entry books, and you know initially all the transactions are recorded in these prime entry books, and thereafter you will be posting those double entries to the general ledger. Once the double entries are posted to the general ledger, all these accounts will be balanced at the end of the financial period. Once these accounts are balanced, with the end balances, we will be preparing a statement called the trial balance. So we have prepared the trial balance in grade 10. So you are aware of how to prepare the trial balance. And after that, this part is new to you. Whenever there are further adjustments after balancing the accounts, we will be doing these adjustments, and this part will be discussed in very detail in your next lesson. So don't be worried about this part. And finally, we are preparing what is called the financial statements. So you know, the financial statements are prepared in order to find out the financial performance and the financial position of the business. So here, the process which I have explained to you earlier is shown in this diagram. So the input is the transactions, accounting transactions, and in the middle part we will be processing those transactions where we record it in the prime entry books, post to the general ledger, then balance the ledger accounts, prepare the trial balance and do the adjustments, and with this finally we will be getting the financial statements. So what are financial statements? So as you have seen, it is the output of this accounting process. So financial statements are the final output of this accounting process. Usually these financial statements are prepared for a particular period. Usually it will be for 12 months, or else we can say it's a period of 1 year. So these financial statements are prepared to obtain the information with regard to the financial performance and the financial position of the business. As I explained to you earlier, financial performance is whether the business is making profits or losses, and the financial position is the asset liability position of the company. So therefore we will be segregating the financial statements into two basic items: what is called profit and loss statement and the statement of financial position. So these two statements are prepared separately to find out the financial performance and the financial position. So let's look at the profit or loss statement first. So as I said, the profit or loss statement is prepared to identify the financial performance of the business, or else to identify whether the business has made a profit or loss. If so, how much is that profit or loss? Usually this statement is prepared for a specific time period, which means when preparing this statement, we will be considering all the transactions that have been taken place during the entire period. If it is for 12 months from January to December, we will be considering all the transactions that have been taken from 1st of January to 31st of December. And since we are preparing this profit or loss statement to find out the profit or loss, as you know, the profit is the difference between the income and expenses, we will take into consideration all the income generated and the expenses incurred during that particular period. So therefore, finally, the profit or loss shown in the profit or loss statement is attributed to all the business operations that have been taken place during this particular selected time period. And when preparing this particular statement, we will be finding out, we will be calculating the profit or loss in two steps. So first we will be calculating the gross profit, and thereafter in the second part of this statement we are finding out the net profit. So let's see how are we going to calculate the gross profit. So you can see this gross profit is the difference between the sales revenue during the period and the cost of sales during the period. So this particular section considered only the main business operation, the results of the main business operation. So if the sales revenue is greater than the cost of sales, we will have a gross profit. But if the sales revenue is less than the cost of sales, we will be having a gross loss. So let's see how are we going to calculate these individual items in detail. So first here you have how to calculate the sales revenue. Here, since we are calculating the profit or loss for a particular period, we will be considering both cash and credit sales that have been taken place during that particular selected period. As you know, in a business, there can be cash sales as well as credit sales. So if we make credit sales towards the latter part of the year, we may not have been receiving those cash by the end of that particular financial period. So we will have the trade debtors at the end of the period for which we have not received the cash for our sales. But regardless of whether we have received cash or not, that particular sales has been taken place during the period. So therefore, we will take the credit sales also into the total sales revenue during that particular period. So we will not consider about whether we have received the cash or not for whatever the sales we made during the period. So therefore, when you take the sales revenue in preparing the profit or loss statement, you have to take both cash sales as well as the credit sales. Then let's look at the cost of sales. Cost of sales is the cost we have incurred with respect to whatever the goods we have sold and included as sales revenue. So in calculating the cost of sales, we have to take the opening stock at the beginning, and to that we have to add the purchases during the year and any expenses relating to these purchases. And finally, we have to deduct whatever the remaining stock from these purchases, or else we can say the closing stock at the end of the period. So finally, we can get the cost of sales. So here also, when we are taking the purchases for our profit or loss statement, as we have considered both the cash sales as well as credit sales in sales revenue, in the purchases also we have to take both the cash purchases as well as credit purchases. So similar to the sales, we might have certain purchases done during the year on credit for what we have not settled that credit by the end of the financial period. So those are regarded as credit purchases, but still we have to take that sale, that purchases also into consideration when we take the purchases figure. And also we have to add the purchases related expenses during the period. So even we have purchased the goods from outside, sometimes we might have to incur some other expenses in order to bring that goods into the business, or else to bring those purchases into the current position and the current status. So these are particularly the expenses incurred in bringing the stocks into the current position and the condition. Some of the examples for these purchases related expenses are given here, like transportation expenses, loading and unloading expenses, carriage inwards, So those are some of the expenses which we had to incur in order to bring the stocks into the current position and the condition, or else to the saleable level. Then we have identified two other important things. Those are closing stocks and the opening stocks. So what are closing stocks? So even we have purchased lot of goods during the period, all the goods which we have purchased during the year may not have been sold by the end of the period. Some of those goods might be retained at the business by the end of the period, or else there may be some unsold items in our stores at the end of the period. So those unsold stock, or the remaining purchases, or the stock at the end of the financial period is called the closing stocks. So closing stocks will be an asset to the business, and that will be carried forward to the next financial year. Then you have the opening stock. So here you can see that the closing stocks will be carried forward to the next accounting period. So this becomes the opening stock of the next financial year. So if that is the case, a newly started business at the very first financial year, they cannot have opening stocks, because that will be their first financial year, and thereafter they might have opening stocks. So let's look at the activity 1 in your textbook. There you have a Nisha Stationery's business, and some of the details were given in your textbook, and it's in your page number 50. So if you look at that particular activity, you can see there are cash sales for 80,000, credit sales for 120,000, cash purchases, and some of the other items are listed. So from that, let's calculate the gross profit of the Nisha Stationery's business. So to calculate that, first we have to find out what is the total sales for the financial period and the total purchases for the financial year. So you can see in your activity there are cash sales as well as credit sales. So here, according to the activity information in the activity, cash sales is 80,000 and credit sales is 120,000, and both together will give you the total sales revenue for the financial period, and that comes to 200,000. And thereafter you have the cash purchases of 45,000, credit purchases of 75,000, and both together will give you the total purchases during the year of 120,000. So thereafter, in the activity, you are given the opening stock as at the 1st January, and it is 15,000. And to that, you have to add the total purchases which we have calculated earlier, that is 120,000. We will be adding that figure. Apart from that, there are a few purchases related expenses given in the activity. Loading expenses of 6,000, carriage inward expenses of 7,000, and all four items add together will give you the cost of goods to be sold. It is 148,000, and from that the closing stock value is given as a 31st December, that is 18,000, and from the cost of goods to be sold we will be deducting the closing stock of 18,000, and we come to the figure called cost of sales, which is 130,000. Thereafter we can calculate the gross profit. So we have the total sales of 200,000 for the period, and then we have the cost of sales figure calculated as 130,000. So we will be deducting the cost of sales figure from the total sales figure, and that will give our gross profit of 70,000. Right, then let's move on to the second part of the profit or loss statement, that is to calculate the net profit. Now, as you know, businesses may not engage only in the main business. Sometimes, you know, there are some additional cash reserves in the business. So what do we do with the additional cash reserves remaining in a business? Are we to keep it in the safe? No, because it won't earn you any return. So therefore, businesses might go and invest those additional cash reserves in some other investments, like in a fixed deposit, or else to purchase some shares from the share market. Likewise, can do a lot of things from the additional cash reserves to earn some additional income. Similar to that, it's not only the cost of sales that the businesses incurred as expenses for the period in doing the business. There may be some expenses to pay the utility bills, to pay the salaries of the employees, cleaning staff, telephone bills, and there may be lot of other expenses that a business might have to incur when doing the business. So in our earlier part, where we calculated the gross profit, we did not consider any of these other expenses or other income into our consideration. So therefore, in the second part of the profit or loss statement, we will be considering all those other income and expenses as well. Then only we can find out how much is the net profit that the business has earned during the period. So here it says, once the gross profit is calculated, we will be moving into the next step. So in that, we will include all the other income as well as other expenses in and adjust those into the gross profit figure and find out the net profit. So what are we include in this process? Other income. Here, as you know, income is items which increase the owner's equity, except the introduction of new capital, are known as income. Say for example, interest earned from the fixed deposit, rent income from the rented out properties, dividend income from the share investments, likewise discounts received. So those will give you some additional income other than the sales revenue. Sales revenue is your main income. Apart from that, you will have some sort of other income as listed here. What are the expenses that we should include in calculating the net profit? Here, the expenses are described as the items which decrease the owner's equity, except drawings, are known as the other expenses. So these expenses will again be categorized into four types. Here you have the four types: distribution expenses, administration expenses, financial expenses, and other expenses. And let's look at each type separately. First, we have the distribution expenses. So these are the expenses which are incurred in selling and distribution of the goods, such as like the delivery charges. So whenever a customer purchased some fixed asset from the a large item from your business, you might have to provide them the transport delivery service to that customer as well. So in that case, you have to incur some expenses in delivering those goods to the customer's doorstep. So therefore, you have to incur a cost. Sometimes you may have to do some advertising to promote your goods and services. So you have the advertising expenses, and sometimes you might have to give some discounts to increase your sales. So therefore, discounts given will again be a distribution expense to you. And the sales staff salaries, these are the staff who are purely engaged in sale of goods and services. The salaries of these people will come under distribution expenses. Then you have the administration expenses. These are the expenses incurred to administrate the business, like the salary, office staff salaries, the electricity bills, telephone bills, stationery cost, the rent of the building where the business is operating. So these are some sort of administration expenses. Then you have the financial expenses. As you know, sometimes the owner's equity may not be enough to carry out the business activities. In that case, the businesses have to borrow money from the financial institutions. If the businesses are borrowing money from other institutions like banks, they have to pay some interest cost for their borrowings. So it costs you, and this interest for the bank loans taken will be taken as a financial expense. And if you if the business is having a bank current account, and if it operates under a bank overdraft, the overdraft interest again be classified under financial expenses. And sometimes the banks may charge some expenses with regard to issuing of checkbooks likewise. So those bank charges will also come under the financial expenses. Then finally, we have the other expenses. Whatever the expenses which does not classify under the previously discussed three types, the distribution, administration, and financial expenses. So all those expenses will classify under the other expenses. So examples would be loss of cash, damages due to fire, likewise. So those are the items which we have to include in calculating the net profit. So we'll be discussing the format of the profit or loss statement in the next section. So thank you very much, and God bless you.